Welcome to the first meeting of Session 6 of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee. I'm Ariane Burgess, MSP for the Highlands and Islands and the oldest member of the committee, and I have the pleasure of convening this meeting for the first two items of business. No apologies have been received. I would like to take this opportunity to welcome all members, and I look forward to working with you on this committee. Before we move to the first item on the agenda, I'd like to remind everyone present to switch mobile phones to silent. I've just done that myself. A reminder to members to wait for your name to be called before speaking to give time for broadcast colleagues to activate the microphones. Broadcast colleagues will mute microphones for those not speaking to keep ambient noise down and prevent distortion. So we're absolutely in good hands for this first meeting. The first agenda item is for each of us to declare any interests that we have relevant to the work of the committee. Background information is provided in the Declaration of Interest, Paper 1. I will ask each member in turn, in alphabetical order, to either declare any interest or to say that you have no relevant interest to declare. So I'd like to begin with my committee colleague, Karen Adam. Karen.
Good morning. I have no interest to declare. Thank you.
Thank you, Karen. Alistair Allen.
I've no particular interest to declare, but would refer members to my register of interest.
Thank you. And I get to go next. And I have no particular interest, relevant interest to declare. Finlay Carson.
Declare an interest in a farming and letting business, and I'm also a member of the National Farmers Union of Scotland.
Great, thank you, Finlay. And Jim Fairley.
Declare I'm a member of the National Farmers Union of Scotland, other than that, I have no other.
Sorry, I didn't catch that last bit.
Other than that, I have no other external interest.
Thank you very much, Jim. And Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you. I have no interest to declare with regards to this committee. However, I would refer members to my register of interest. Thank you.
Thank you, Rachel. Liam MacArthur. Good morning, Liam.
Good morning, Ariana. Other than being an islander, I have no registerable interest in this committee, but like others, would refer to my register of interest. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Jenny Minto.
Hi, Ariane. Like Liam, I live on an island, but apart from that, I have no relevant interest to declare. However, I refer you to my register of interest.
Thank you. And Mercedes Villalba.
Hi, morning. I have no relevant interest to declare.
Thank you, Mercedes. That's great. So we're going to move on to agenda item number two, which is to choose our convener. So the committee's next task is to choose a convener, and the procedure is explained in the choice of convener papers, paper number two. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party are eligible for nomination as conveners of this committee. Can I invite a member of the Scottish Conservative and Unionist Party to nominate their candidate for convener?
An R in the box.
Rachel Hamilton. Thank you.
Thank you. I would like to nominate Finlay Carson as convener.
Thank you, Rachel. Do we agree to choose Finlay Carson as our convener? Please indicate any objections by typing R into the chat function. Okay, I see no objections to Finlay Carson being our convener for the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee. And I want to welcome Finlay Carson to your appointment and Absolutely. Congratulations. And I look forward to working with you in your role as convener.
Thank you very much, Ariana. I appreciate those kind words. I'm absolutely delighted and honoured to be taking the role of convener of this committee. It's got the unfortunate name of Rain, which is not quite as nice as Eclair, the previous committee I served on, but I'm quite sure it will be a fascinating committee, and we do have a huge amount of work to do in an area that I know all of you are particularly interested and look forward to working with you and the clerks and Spice over the next few months. I'll move on to agenda item 3, and it's choice of deputy convener. The Parliament has agreed that only members of the Scottish Liberal Democrats are eligible for nomination as deputy convener of this committee. I understand that Liam MacArthur is that party's nominee. Do we have any objections to Liam MacArthur as our deputy convener? If you do so, please place a R in the chat function. Nope, we have no objections. So I'd like to congratulate Liam MacArthur on being the deputy convener of our committee, and I look forward to working with you over the months. Now move on to agenda item 4. Agenda item 4 is a provisional discussion about the legacy papers produced by both the Environment, Climate Change, Landform Committee and the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee at the end of session 5. These papers summarise the committee's recommendation in relation to the ways of working based on the experience over the previous session, and highlights work that we think that this committee may wish to focus on. I propose to invite members to highlight any aspects in the legacy papers that they consider particularly important for our future work programme. So what I'll do is I'll call on members individually. I'll not call on alphabetically, but probably start with those who have had experience on the committees before. And I'll call on Liam MacArthur to make comment on the committee's work programme. Liam.
Thanks very much, convener, and thank you to the committee for electing me as the deputy convener. Like you, I consider it a real privilege. I think, like you, convener, I looked at the legacy papers of both the kind of relevant committees to the work of this committee from the previous session, and it didn't lack for options in terms of issues that I think will be under some pressure and expectation to be covering. I mean, it seems to me logical we'll need to continue the work in relation to the operation of the internal markets, the rural frameworks issues. I think added to that, we've got the questions around future trade deals that are being pursued and which Parliament has already given some consideration to, but I think it's an opportunity within this committee maybe to drill down into that a bit. The Good Food Nation, I mean, I'm assuming we will have a bill to deal with in due course, but it's whether we can squeeze out some time before legislation starts to flow forward to do a bit of kind of pre-legislative consultation in some of the areas the Good Food Nation is likely to cover. Aquaculture, to me, seems to be something we're going to have to revisit as well, from a more sort of islands perspective. I would have a very keen interest in us continuing to shine a light on issues around ferry procurement. And I know there's a bit of dubiety about whether or not digital connectivity sits within our remit or perhaps in another committee's remit. But if we have any locus in that, I think that has demonstrated itself over the last 18 months to be an issue of almost existential importance to many island and rural communities, and it's something I think we could usefully turn our attention to. I think the one other in closing that I would maybe flag up, it's not on the list. I know the Petitions Committee were looking at a petition in relation to air traffic control service centralisation. But obviously that cuts across interests of this committee as well. So I think probably need to wait to see what the Petitions Committee seeks to do with that. I know it's part of their legacy paper, but again, if there's a way of following that up with appropriate, I'd be very supportive of that.
Thank you, Liam. I should have said right at the outset that we do recognise that there will be some outstanding questions about where our remit actually falls, whether you know, there's crossover between net zero energy transport committee's remit, and I propose to write to the Scottish Government after this session just to have some clarity in advance of our business planning meeting. But please don't hesitate and bring forward you know, topics which you think maybe this the remit of this committee, and we can certainly clarify that before we move forward. Can I now ask Alistair to make comment?
In the papers that we've got, as has been mentioned there by Liam, and there's obvious things in there like COP26 or CAP and replacements for CAP and trade deals and all those kind of issues, but like Liam, I think it's interesting that we've got a committee with three islanders, or three people who live on islands. So apologies if we try to do a takeover from time to time, but I think I would echo what Liam said there about the fact that many of the issues that affect islands and perhaps other parts of the country as well are ultimately all about depopulation. And so there will be some crossover between issues and, I suppose, possibly some negotiations done with other committees about where exactly our remit lies. But for me, I think an issue that's impossible to avoid if we're talking about the rural economy or the island economy is housing. I realise we're not the housing committee, but it's an example of one of these areas that we cannot avoid straying into, because we won't have an economy in some parts of the country if we don't have anywhere for people to live. So, for me, I think that would be the observations I would make, is that I think we probably just need to clarify if we have opportunities to do more sort of holistic, if you like, or cross-cutting looks at some of the economic issues that affect island areas and other areas affected by depopulation, which we in other committees' areas, or we might need to negotiate with them about it.
Thank you, Alistair. I absolutely agree. I think whilst there may be three members who are islands in the truest sense, coming from Galloway and West Dumfries, we often feel like we're an island as well, and the housing is certainly an issue with us. There may also be some remit when it comes to the rurally based enterprise agencies, so Highlands and Islands, and also the South Scotland Enterprise Agency. That's something we need to look at as well. Rachel Hamilton, can I move on to you, please? Thanks.
Thank you, convener, and congratulations to both you and Liam MacArthur. I also am slightly unclear about where our remit will lie, but looking at some of the legacy papers, I'm very interested in pursuing the food and farming future policy agenda. I think it's very important that farmers know where they're going, that they have a direction, and I think our committee could very much be looking and scrutinising at what the Scottish Government are bringing forward, and that might lie quite nicely with post-EU legislative competence and other issues surrounding that landscape. Obviously, the big thing for us is going to be COP26, and I think it's how we feed into that in terms of our remit in the committee and the responsibilities that will be expected of agriculture in Scotland as part of that net zero solution, or part of their role that they play in reaching net zero, including emission targets. I think it's also important that we look at the, if it is our remit, to look at the Deer Act and deer and grouse legislation. Obviously, there was a slight issue which BASC had raised with regards to the way that people in agriculture, rural workers, are being treated. I think that's an important aspect that we should be looking at. The one thing that interested me greatly was the review of the salmon farming inquiry. I wasn't part of the committee at that point, but I think it would be worth looking at how progress has been made in terms of some of the kind of voluntary code of conduct and other aspects that the committee raised previously. Another aspect that I think is going to be really important is marine biodiversity, and I think we should be looking at that. And finally, wildlife protection. And I also think it's very important that the point that Alistair Allen raises about the island communities, again, I don't think housing is really our remit, but it's about rural life. And that obviously takes into account some of the work that we did in the last committee with regards to the ferry inquiry and connectivity. So there's a lot to go on, as you say, Finlay, and I think we've got our work cut out, but I'm really looking forward to contributing to the committee and working with all the fabulous clerks that we heard from this morning.
Thank you very much, Rachel. Can I now move on to Ariane, please?
Thank you, convener. So from the work of the REC committee, rural economy and connectivity, things that stood out to me, well, of course, everything, and my colleagues have already said quite a lot of what I would agree with, but I'll just emphasize a few things and pick up some things. So absolutely, whatever form of food bill, Good Food Nation, or whatever comes forward, I think that's absolutely important. The salmon aquaculture, I would like to look at that again. I'm quite concerned about the direction of travel there. And as well, the inshore fisheries. I think that's really an important piece of work that we need to look at, maybe some restoration of limits. As well, I'd like to pick up crofting. I feel like there's some work we could be doing there in terms of derelict crofts and supporting the work of the Crofting Commission to actually bring more land back into use when we have so many people who actually want to have and work crofts. Of course, always there's going to be climate change plans. I'm keen to look at anything to do with climate change. And then in terms of the work of Eclair, I think that was the Environment, Climate Change and Land Reform Committee. Things that stand out for me there is how we look at a green recovery and, while responding to our twin emergencies of climate and nature. I'd also like to look at land reform because I think that underpins so much. It's part of what underpins the housing issue that Alistair Allen referred to. Of course, COP26 as well. And I just want to say that I'm not an islander. I'd maybe love to be, but I do live rurally. And, that's why I chose to be on this committee. And also I am on the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And the reason that I asked to be the green spokesperson for these areas before getting on these committees was because at the heart for me is the issue around rural depopulation or repopulation and making sure that we have places for young people who want to stay and places, affordable housing for people who are coming to provide services, much needed services to our rural communities. So for me, all of this is community is at heart and we need to make sure it's people and land and the environment all together. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I move now on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, Fairley. And congratulations on your convenership and to great to meet the rest of the group in this setting. There are definitely issues I'd like for us to pursue, the UK Internal Market Act, how that's going to affect farm funding going forward, the EU, the Brexit implications on devolution and the implications of how that will affect the rural economy, the future rural policy, what that's going to look like. I absolutely agree that the farming community need to have a degree of certainty. As you and I both know, farming isn't about tomorrow or the day after. It's about a generation in front of us. So we need to get some kind of certainty on what that looks like. The Good Food Nation Bill, as it was, I would certainly like to see us looking at that again. Food is it's not just farming I'm interested in. It's farming, it's food, it's the environment, it's the rural depopulation, as Ariane was just talking about. All of those things to me are utterly connected. Women in agriculture, That's something that was looked at in the last session, and I think it's something that we should pursue further. I think it's the progress that we've made has been okay, but I think we could make a hell of a lot more progress in encouraging more women to get involved in agriculture and actually running the businesses, because they're more than capable of doing it, as we've witnessed in numerous occasions over the last 2 or 3 years. Inshore fisheries, I think that's vital. We've got an absolute jewel in the crown, and it's something I think we really need to be protecting. Digital connectivity. I mean, we all know the problems with digital connectivity, even in urban areas, let alone what it's like in the rural constituency. And I'd really like us to try and investigate how we bring together two disparate groups. Rachel talked there about how the rural population feel as though they are not represented in this parliament. And yet, I have written some support in support of the gamekeeping fraternity on Twitter, and was immediately bombarded from the other side. And I'm saying the other side at this stage because we currently are two sides of an argument. And I'd like to find some way of bringing them together, because the two of them cannot and will not, should not be mutually exclusive. There has got to be a way of making those two separate groups come together and work out what's the best way to protect the raptors, to protect our environment, but not at the expense of losing rural jobs, which are absolutely vital to stopping rural depopulation. So there's a whole interlink of stuff going on there that I'm very keen to have a look at. Transport requirements. Now, I live in Perthshire, but even we have transport problems in Perthshire. So it must be an absolute torturous journey for people like yourself, then away down the deep borders or up in the highlands and islands. And housing, as I say, even in Perthshire, we've got rural housing problems. It's something that we need to look at across the board, I think. And if that's not enough to be going on, I'm quite sure there's more we can find.
Thank you very much, Jim. I appreciate that. It's certainly, there's a lot of food for thought, excuse the pun, but I think just your contribution alone just gives us an indication of the remit that we've got. Jenny Minto, welcome, Jenny. Can I ask you for your comments, please?
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Finlay, and congratulations on your convenership, and also to Liam as well. And I'm really looking forward to working with everyone across the group, and also the fantastic experts that the Parliament provides us with. Finlay, I would just say one thing. I actually think RAIN is probably the most appropriate title for this committee, because without RAIN, well, we wouldn't have the wonderful Green Scotland and Blue Scotland that we actually have. Like everyone has said, this is a fantastic committee. It's got such a wide remit. And just as I was reading the legacy papers, I represent Argyll and Bute, as you know, and I feel Argyll and Bute takes so many of the boxes on it, as does the rest of rural Scotland. I won't repeat what everybody else has said, but like Alistair, living on an island, I absolutely understand the housing, the depopulation, the ferries, the connectivity. That's the same in rural, remote Argyll and Bute as well, and rural, remote Scotland. I think there is some fantastic work that's already been done that we can grow on. People have talked a bit about food and the Scottish brand that is food. Well, there's wonderful research done there, and we're talking about absolutely great, really top products. Can we look at that across the rural economy for other industries, perhaps fabric, and use it as well, you know, for tourism, so widen out the fantastic research that's been done there. What Ariane was talking about is the one thing I wrote down as well, is communities, and we absolutely have to recognise the importance of our rural communities. We have to recognise the input that farmers, fishermen, crofters, aquaculture all put in, but we have to get the right balance with the environment, with all these organisations. So, and I also can't not say land reform as well. That's something that I think the community has to work. This group has to work very clearly together. And I think just finally, Ariane said it, I'd written it down as well, people in the land, we're in this together. We need to get through it together. So a huge remit, very exciting, loads of work, but very pleased to be part of it. Can I just say one other thing? one of the things that I really picked up from the two legacy documents was how we gather the evidence and lived experience. Now, we've all got lived experience, and I think we really need to make sure we get out into our communities to ensure we're gathering as widely as we can from people's lived experience and what they know about their communities.
Thank you very much, Jenny. I'm glad you mentioned that. Kate Smith, who we briefly met in the briefing session, from participation and community team, did a fantastic job for the Clare committee in the last session, making sure that we didn't just get the opinions of stakeholders, or if some people like to call it opinion holders, but it was a broad selection of people who had various different opinions on the topic matter. So looking forward again to working with Kate Smith to ensure that we do exactly that and get a broad spectrum of opinions from right across our communities and stakeholders. Can I now move on to Karen Adam? Welcome, Karen.
Hello. Is my microphone working? You can hear me. Much like my colleagues here, I'm really, really excited and looking forward to being a part of this committee, myself representing a very coastal and rural community. Of course, I will have, I'll definitely be interested in everything fishing and fisheries. I think it was Rachel that picked up on, the marine biodiversity. I think one of the recommendations from the Clare committee, which was really important, was looking at an integrated approach in regards to scrutiny. And I think having that holistic outlook towards that would be really helpful and beneficial moving forward with all aspects of my marine biodiversity, particularly scrutinising the outcome of the post-EU exit negotiations between the UK, EU and other coastal states, particularly its implications for sustainable fisheries in Scottish waters, I think is really important. In regards to engaging with debates on human rights mainstreaming, I think looking at the relevance to the environment on this and considering how our committees may be best to scrutinise any forthcoming human rights legislation. For the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee, within that legacy report, what I really picked up on was, I think Jim touched upon this, was the women in agriculture, and particularly looking at the work that the task force did and, working upon what they've already done and taking their suggestions forward and continuing with implementations of that, digital connectivity, transport, particularly COVID implications. The pandemic's had significant impacts on agriculture, fisheries and aquaculture. And I think we need to be definitely looking at what we can do in regards to our recovery and making sure that we get off on the right foot with that. Housing, particularly has been brought up, and I agree with that, and keeping a young workforce within the area is something that's often brought up, and I think if we can find ways, it's such a large remit here, but everything is very much connected, and having that holistic approach towards transport, broadband connectivity, and making sure there's jobs for our young people, all part of this committee and everything that I'm really looking forward to getting stuck into. It's just such a huge remit. It's hard to know where to start, but I'm really looking forward to it. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Karen. And absolutely not last but not least, Mercedes, and I hope I don't pronounce your surname wrong. Is it Villalba?
Simple as that. Thank you, Convener. It's great to be here this morning. It's a really exciting committee with a huge remit, seemingly endless, and so much potential. So I'm really excited to be a part of it. I represent the Northeast region, which I think others here represent constituencies within that region. And like so much of the rest of Scotland, it's got an abundance of natural heritage. It's really beautiful, but we struggle with infrastructure to make it a fantastic place for people to grow up in and stay. So I see a lot of potential with this committee to look at what we can do to make the rural and coastal areas of Scotland really vibrant. So looking at connectivity in terms of digital infrastructure, as well as transport, which has already been mentioned, looking at jobs around food and agriculture, and making exploring workers' rights in those areas, and also support for farmers and business owners to diversify and restore nature, which hopefully will elongate the businesses anyway. So I think there's huge scope. So much has already been mentioned, much of which I agree with. And I'm just really excited to get started. I think the key things for me, as actually Ariane said, is looking at how we can move forward policies which benefit and work for nature, people, and the land, and having that kind of holistic, integrated approach which benefits all of us.
Great. Thank you very much, Mercedes. What I would like to do now, I'm going to make some comments, but if anybody would like to make a further contribution, if you put an R in the chat box, I'll call you and we can turn your mic on. I think the last 15 minutes has certainly given us a wake-up call about just how much work we've got to do. We could be the lead committee when it comes to Scottish Water, Nature Scot, Marine Scotland, SEPA, which in itself, there's quite a bit of work to do there to ensure they're working efficiently and scrutinising the work they do. We've touched on aquaculture. That was a major report in the last session that both the Clare and the Rural Affairs Committee worked on, which had a huge amount of public interest. So there may be a need for looking at the wild salmon population or the freshwater environment on a broader scale with non-native invasive species and so on, which is having an impact on our biodiversity, which, as we all know, is in crisis, along with the climate change crisis that we face. Some of the mitigation plans that the government have at the moment, we will probably need to look at. So forestry planting to try and hit our net zero targets, and what the implication on forestry planting is on our natural environment as a whole, and peat restoration. We touched on the blue recovery, so marine carbon potentially, so not just freshwater environment, but also our seas around our coast, and to look at what's happening to species decline, and that goes hand in hand with our inshore fisheries. So possibly a bit of work to do there. And then, of course, as Jim touched on, we've got, I think we're past calling it CAP reform, but we're looking at rural payments, new rural policies, and how that will tie in potentially with land use strategies, the local land use strategy, and the new groups have been set up to look at land groups and how farming and environmental issues can taken forward in that. The ongoing implications of Brexit, I'm glad you touched on the parliamentary scrutiny, what our role is when it comes to the UK internal market and the animal welfare and food standards in future trade deals. Crofting, Crown Estate, there's a huge amount of work and animal welfare. I think some of the members of the previous committees, when they put the legacy papers together, they must have had a good idea that they weren't going to be coming back and serving on these committees, because they've certainly given us a massive of workload. And communications, I think it's really important that the work that we do is communicated to everybody, not just inside the Parliament, but into our communities, to get as much engagement as possible. I know certainly the CLEAR committee in the last session was particularly good at that. Arianna, can I bring you in again, please?
Thank you, convener. Yes, we certainly have a lot. And I just wanted to pick up, because you brought forestry up, and I want to pick something up because I think we have a fantastic opportunity, not only with the, you know, looking at forestry in terms of carbon capture and biodiversity, but also, you know, how can we grow trees, looking, you know, because forestry is a long-term, you know, vision as much as agriculture. How can we grow the trees and therefore the timber that we could be building houses in Scotland from? And how can we grow trees that we can be making added value products? So where's the investment for added value, you know, fiber manufacturing plant or something like that in rural Scotland? You know, either in the south or the or up by me, we could haggle over that. But I think there's some tremendous opportunities to, you know, start to look at as we move away from oil and gas and all the products that are made from oil and gas. We need to start thinking about how do we make them out of things that we can grow in Scotland. So I'd love us to have a first look at that as well. And I just want to come back in and really underscore women in agriculture. I'm right there. I really want to support looking into that. I know I met some amazing women, pioneers, and I think we need to do the work to open the doors and support more into the sector.
Absolutely. I could agree with you more. I think that could be built around the wider issue of succession planning when it comes to farming businesses. It's something I was involved with the Young Farmers for many years, and it was an issue way back then, 40 years ago it must be now, but succession planning was an issue, and we didn't you know, look specifically at women in agriculture, which I think was a failing back then. So yeah, there's quite a bit of work to be done to see how our future generations of farmers and the entrepreneurial behaviour in farming tend to come from the young people. Not always, I don't want to be ageist, but we certainly need to you know, pay due regard to how agriculture is going to develop over the short term and absolutely long term. Rachel, can I bring you in, please?
Thank you. If we had an idea how we would be shaping, what would we be taking forward? Because obviously Ariane makes the point there about specific aspects that she's interested in, and we all have indeed this morning. However, if we look at the umbrella subjects such as the future of food and farming policy, that without a doubt brings in procurement, and procurement is an issue that would be pursued through, for example, the Good Food Bill. It wouldn't necessarily take into account where you know, stocks of timber are going and whether those could be used, indigenous timber could be used to make houses, but it's all part of the big procurement tent. And I wondered if you had any idea as when we might get a bit of direction as to how we take these subjects that we're interested in and our remit.
Yeah, good question, Rachel. I think, again, it's we've got a big task ahead of us, not just but on the remit, but also you know, tying that down. I think in the previous committees, the huge remit inevitably resulted in some areas, it's only scratching the surface of the topics that we were engaged in and not scrutinising properly. So we have to be aware that there's some topics we have to focus on more than others. But that will be part of the work programme meeting we have, hopefully in at the end of August, just before we come back formally in the Parliament. And the clerks have got a lot of work to do to try and pull together some suggestions for the work plan for us to discuss it at that meeting. And again, what we'll need to clarify just exactly what the remit is and where it crosses over with other committees. Jim?
There is, crossing my mind, just when Arianna was talking about forestry and we were talking about the perception of the rural community feeling as though they're left behind by the Central Belt Scottish Government, which I disagree with. But it's the conflicts. It's the conflicts that we have. I absolutely get that we have and needs to tackle the climate emergency. Planting trees is definitely recognised as being one of them, but it's 18,000 hectares of trees per year in the right place with the right kind of trees. I think that's probably more important than getting numbers. So it's trying to bring the conflicts that we currently have and bring people together so that we can actually talk about it in a balanced way so that we can find the right solutions, because there's something here for all of us to get a result out of. When I say a result, I mean something that everybody's happy with, that we can continue to keep the rural population where they are and working, that we can continue to hit our climate change targets. And it doesn't have to always be in a conflict way. And I'd really like us to focus on how we bring those issues together so that we actually find proper solutions rather than just making it a political football.
Absolutely, Jim. And I think if you look back at the work that the CLEAR Committee and the Rural Affairs Committee did, certainly in the CLEAR Committee, the committee worked very well together to look at how we came to the best solution. And that did involve compromise from each side, but we had very few votes. We had very few divisions within the committee. Our committee reports they were very consensual. So I would like to think that going forward, the evidence we'll be able to gather from stakeholders and we'll be able to work in a very joined up manner to try and get the best policies, the best laws, best solutions for everybody. And that will, in some cases, involve compromise, but I'm sure we will be able to get to the best solutions. We unfortunately only have till 10:15 today. We could probably talk for the next week about the remit and setting out what we think we need to achieve over the next few years. But if the members agree, we'll discuss an initial work programme at an informal business planning event towards the end of the summer recess. Preference would be to try and get the members into Parliament physically rather than virtually. Unfortunately, because of the COVID restrictions and where we are at the moment, we're going to be unable to have an away day, which is always a fantastic team building opportunity, so we can speak to each other formally and informally and try to get to know each other a little bit better. We're not going to be able to do that before the Parliament reconvenes in September. But hopefully we can have a face-to-face business planning meeting sometime towards the end of August. If everyone's in agreement, the committee clerks will be in touch with members regarding the arrangements around that informal planning session, and it will be organised to pay due regard to the restrictions that will be in place at that time. But if there's no other comments, I would like to thank you all very much. And just once again say that I'm absolutely looking forward to working with you all and what I believe will be the best committee in the Parliament. So not only do I have the best constituency, I've now got the best committee. I'm delighted to go into the recess on that basis. So thank you all very much, and I look forward to your hard work and getting to know all better when we have our next meeting. So I bring this meeting to a close. Thank you.